Good morning, and welcome to online worship at All Saints Episcopal Church in Wolfboro, New Hampshire, on this first Sunday in February 2021. We're thankful that you've chosen to worship with us this morning. As Pastor Bill will be leading us in a rite of healing a bit later in this service, it is certainly our prayer that all of our hearts would be open to receive whatever touch of healing, comfort, and encouragement that we may need in this day. To prepare us for this time, I'm opening with a lovely organ arrangement of a favorite hymn, Healer of Our Every Ill, which we will be singing together a bit later in the service.
Thank you. Blessed be the one holy and living God. Glory to God forever and ever. Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. God be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray together. Set us free, O God, from the bondage of our sins, and give us the liberty of that abundant life which you have made known to us in your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Reading from the book of Isaiah. Have you not known? Have you not heard? Has it not been told to you from the beginning? Have you not understood from the foundations of the earth? It is he who sits above the circle of the earth, and its inhabitants are like grasshoppers, who stretches out the heavens like a curtain and spreads them like a tent to live in, who brings princes to naught and makes the rulers of the earth as nothing. Scarcely are they planted, scarcely sown, scarcely has their stem taken root in the earth, when he blows upon them, and they wither, and the tempest carries them off like stubble. To whom then will you compare me? Or who is my equal? Says the Holy One. Lift up your eyes on high and see. Who created these? He who brings out their host and numbers them, calling them all by name, because he is great in strength, mighty in power. No one is missing. Why do you say, O Jacob, and speak, O Israel, my way is hidden from the Lord, and my right is disregarded by my God? Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. He gives power to the faint and strengthens the powerless. Even youths will faint and be weary, and the young will fall exhaustedly. But those who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read. I'll read, and you will respond responsively to Psalm 147. Hallelujah! How good it is to sing praises to our God.
How pleasant it is to honor him with praise.
The Lord rebuilds Jerusalem.
He gathers the exiles of Israel.
He heals the brokenhearted.
And binds up their wounds.
He counts the number of the stars.
And calls them all by their names.
Great is the Lord, and mighty in power.
There is no limit to his wisdom.
The Lord lifts up the lowly,
but casts the wicked to the ground.
Sing to the Lord with thanksgiving.
Make music to our God upon the harp.
He covers the heavens with clouds,
and prepares rain for the earth.
He makes the grass to grow upon the mountains,
and green plants to serve mankind.
He provides food for flocks and herds,
and for the young ravens when they cry.
He is not impressed by the might of a horse.
He has no pleasure in the strength of a man.
But the Lord has pleasure in those who fear him,
in those who await his gracious favor. Alleluia.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Corinthians. If I proclaim the gospel, this gives me no ground for boasting. For an obligation is laid on me, and woe to me if I do not proclaim the gospel. For I do this of my own will. I have reward. But if not of my own will, I am entrusted with a commission. What then is my reward? Just this, that in my proclamation I may make the gospel free of charge, so as not to make full use of my rights in the gospel. For though I am free with respect to all, I have made myself a slave to all, so that I might win more of them. To the Jews I became as a Jew in order to win Jews. To those under the law, I became as one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so that I might win those under the law. To those outside the law, I became as one outside the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under God's law, so that I might win those outside the law. To the weak, I became weak, so that I might win the weak. I become all things to all people, that I might by my means save some. I do it all for the sake of the gospel, so that I may share in its blessings. Hear what the Spirit is saying to the churches.
Thanks be to God.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Mark.
Glory to you, Lord Christ.
When Jesus and his disciples left the synagogue, they entered the house of Simon and Andrew with James and John. Now Simon's mother-in-law was in bed with a fever, and they told him about her at once. He came and took her by the hand and lifted her up. Then the fever left her, and she began to serve them. That evening at sundown, they brought to him all who were sick or possessed with demons, and the whole city was gathered around the door. And he cured many who were sick with various diseases and cast out many demons, and he would not permit the demons to speak because they knew him. In the morning, while it was still very dark, he got up and went out to a deserted place, and there he prayed. And Simon and his companions hunted for him. When they found him, they said to him, "Everyone is searching for you." He answered, "Let us go on to the neighboring towns, so that I may proclaim the message there also, for that is what I came out to do." And he went throughout Galilee, proclaiming the message in their synagogues and casting out demons. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
In Isaiah today, the one God who sits above the earth and numbers the stars gives strength to those who are weary. The psalmist sings of the Lord's healing and binding of wounds, lifting up the lowly. And the Gospel of Mark shows us that in Jesus' healing work is the hand of the Creator God lifting up the sick woman to health and service. Following Jesus, we too are lifted up and healed to serve, strengthening the powerless, feeding the hungry, binding up the brokenhearted. And then, like Jesus, we too are renewed and strengthened by quiet times of prayer. Poet, pastor, and theologian Frederick Buechner says that waiting for Jesus is not just a passive thing or some kind of a pious, prayerful, churchy thing. To wait for Jesus is to act in Jesus' place as fully as we know how. To wait for Jesus, he says, is to be Jesus to those who need us, to be Jesus to them most, to bring them the most we have of his healing and hope, because unless we bring it, it may never be brought at all. So how do we act? How do we bring the healing and the hope of Jesus? This week, as I wrestled with this question, I was reminded of a newer hymn, "We Come to You for Healing, Lord," which was written in 2002 by the late Reverend Dr. Herman G. Stumpel. It eloquently echoes what we sometimes struggle to ask God when we are weak and weary. I like it because, unlike so many hymns focused on healing, this one includes the ministry of those in medicine as instruments of God's healing activity. But more importantly, because it acknowledges that healing is not limited to physical illness, but extends to mental, emotional, and spiritual dimensions as well. We come to you for healing, Lord, of body, mind, and soul, and pray that by your Spirit's touch we may again be whole, as once you walked through ancient streets and reached toward those in pain. We know you come among us still with power to heal again. You touch us through physicians' skills, through nurses' gifts of care, and through the love of faithful friends who lift our lives in prayer. Through nights of pain and wakefulness, through days when strength runs low, grant us your gift of patience, Lord, your calming peace to know. We come to you, O loving Lord, in our distress and pain, and trust that through our nights and days, your grace will heal, sustain. During this time of pandemic, we give thanks for God working through all of those in the medical arts and sciences, those who are on the front lines and those who have researched and made vaccines and therapies available. They are the hands and the feet of a loving God, God caring for a hurting world. And as we navigate broken systems to receive the vaccine and long for the restoration of all that has been restricted during this COVID tide, God promises to be with you. God promises to be there even when the situation feels bleak, or the anxiety, the pain, or fear feels too much to bear. And so we pray for our body, our mind, and soul. We call for Jesus' presence and healing power among us. We give thanks for all who lift our lives in prayer. And we ask for patience as we await the Spirit's calming peace, trusting that God's grace will heal and sustain. Yeah, we know that earthly cures are only temporary. Everyone that Jesus heals in the gospel stories will likely get sick again, and all of us will die. We wonder why Jesus heals rather than wipe out the evil, sin, and sickness. We wonder why there is a vaccine and healing therapies, but no COVID cure. We turn to Scripture for guidance and comfort and peace. And today we heard how Jesus healed Simon's mother-in-law from a fever. And today we cry out to God for the 2.23 million people worldwide who have died of a disease plagued with fever. We long for peace in our mourning of the dead, for patience and strength in our vigilance and following precautions that we take to love and serve our neighbor. And today, we pray for the 104 million people who are infected and suffering around the world. Fevers are designated by the medical community as, you know, a heightened body temperature due to some internal malfunction or disease. And it's also metaphorically used to describe crazed enthusiasm. So a fever then designates something that's wrong in the body of a person or of a whole community. And in Hebrew scripture, the list of curses that can be found in Deuteronomy 28 on those who do not keep the covenant includes fever. And while we don't know if the author of Mark considered a fever to be a sign of divine punishment, Jesus lives the way of love, bringing forth the kingdom of God, whether you have fever or not. In Mark, Jesus only heals those who present themselves to him. He never appears to go out in search of problems to remedy and fix. They find him. Jesus' ministry, you see, is not to fix everything or everyone before he is arrested. Jesus, you see, becomes much more than a healer. His work is eternal and permanent. And the word for Jesus lifting up in Mark's story is the same word used for resurrection. Jesus lifting up of the sick woman is not just about healing her fever, but about curing all fevers that curse us as individuals and as communities. God removes the curse through the power of the cross of Jesus, which hangs above us, which focuses us, which guides our very lives, restoring our souls and inviting us to share in eternal life. Let us be in a place of prayer. Good and gracious God, you sent us Jesus to be our great physician, a healing balm for the sin and suffering that burdens and breaks us down. We thank you for working in and through all who labor, using the gifts that you give to share your compassion and to be means for your healing. Bless and keep all who are instruments of your comforting, healing, and sustaining grace until we receive the ultimate cure. We pray in the name of Jesus and in the presence of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen.
Thank you.
Let us profess our faith with the whole church, using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one
God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come.
Amen.
Trusting in God's power to heal, let us offer our prayers for those who are in need, responding to each petition with the words from today's psalm, "We await your steadfast love." We pray for the church's ministries of healing, for hospital, hospice, military chaplains, for those serving in prisons, camps, and institutions, and for bishops, priests, and deacons facing illness of which we are unaware. We pray to you, saving God.
We await your steadfast love.
We pray for the health of the earth, for its myriad animals and their inhabitants, and for all created life that has been harmed by human misuse. We pray to you, provident God.
We await your steadfast love.
We pray for the healing of our nation, for the safety of our nation's elected leaders, for an end to domestic violence, and for an end to prejudice, and for an end to civic terrorism. We pray to you, sovereign God.
We await your steadfast love.
We pray for a halt to the pandemic, for all who have contracted COVID-19, for health workers, for the prompt distribution of vaccines, and for all who today will die from the virus. We pray to you, compassionate God.
We await your steadfast love.
We pray for all who are sick and suffering, for those with chronic pain, for those experiencing despair, for infants born impaired and for the aged in decline, and for all whom we name here, Bob, Ruth, Dylan, Mark, Rodney, Stephanie, Shirley, Carolyn, Gina, Penny, Jan, Faye, Penelope, Mary, Gwendolyn, Mary Ellen, Prue, Judy, Michael, Zell, Felicity, Joe, and Jacqueline. We pray to you, consoling God.
We await your steadfast love.
We pray finally for ourselves, for steady trust in your power and for health in our weakness. We pray to you, loving God.
We await your steadfast love.
We praise you for the faithful departed and for their lives of service to others. And we pray that despite sickness and death, at our end, we join with them to find our wholeness in you. We pray to you, eternal God.
We await your steadfast love.
Merciful God, hear the prayers of your people, spoken or silent, for the sake of the one who dwells among us, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
Amen. Blessed be the Holy Trinity, one God, whose voice is upon the waters, whose mercy is poured out upon all people, whose goodness cascades over all creation. Amen.
Amen.
Let us confess our sins, trusting in the abundant grace of God. Holy God,
you
search us and know us. You are acquainted with all our ways. We confess that our hearts are burdened by sin, our own sins, and the broken systems that bind us. We turn inward, failing to follow your outward way of love. We distrust those who are not like us. We exploit the earth and its resources, and fail to consider generations to come. Forgive us, gracious God, for all we have done and left undone. Even before the words are on our tongues, you know them. Receive them in your divine mercy.
Amen.
How vast is God's grace! Through the power and promise of Christ Jesus, our sins are washed away and we are claimed as God's own beloved. Indeed, we are forgiven. In the wake of God's forgiveness, we are called to be the beloved community, living out Christ's justice and the Spirit's reconciling peace.
Amen. Amen.
We gather at the font of faith and forgiveness for the rite of healing. In its ministry of healing, the Church does not replace the gifts of God that have come through the scientific community, nor does it promise a cure. The Church offers and celebrates gifts such as these: God's presence with strength and comfort in time of suffering, God's promise of wholeness and peace, and God's love embodied in the community of faith. Our Lord Jesus healed many as a sign of the reign of God come near, and sent disciples to continue this work of healing with prayer, with the laying on of hands. In the name of Christ, the great healer and reconciler of the world, we now entrust to God all who are in need of healing. May our Heavenly Father forgive you your sins, release you from suffering, and restore you to wholeness and strength. For all in need of healing, we pray. The Almighty Lord, who is a strong tower to all, who put their trust in him, to whom all things in heaven and on earth and under the earth bow and obey, be now and evermore your defense, and make you know and feel that the only name under heaven given for health and salvation is the name of our Lord Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Amen. May the peace of Christ be always with you.
And also with you.
May that deep peace dwell in you this day. May that deep peace bring comfort and healing this day. Just a couple of brief announcements. We are preparing for Lent. And so we will have Lent bags available after worship next Sunday through Wednesday the 17th, which is Ash Wednesday. And that information is included in our e-news. And I will make another announcement next Sunday about how you can come Sunday afternoon to pick up bags here at the church and from the church office the beginning of next week. Included in those bags will be ashes to go, as well as Eucharist, which we will consecrate next Sunday. We begin a new book this week with Wolfboro Reads, our community book group held with the Congregational Church, and that is on Tuesday afternoon. I commend that to you this week, and also announce that there's been a change for our March book. We will be reading Bishop Curry's new book, as the book on Christian minimalism we had originally planned on will not be published by that date. Let us take our offering. I appeal to you, brethren, by the mercies of God, to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your spiritual worship. The Lord be with you.
And also.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
All honor and praise be yours always and everywhere, mighty Creator, ever-living God, through Jesus Christ, your only Son, our Lord. For at this time we celebrate your glory made present in our midst. In the coming of the Magi, the King of all the world was revealed to the nations. In the waters of baptism, Jesus was revealed as the Christ, the Savior sent to redeem us. And in the water made wine, the new creation was revealed at the wedding feast. Poverty turned to riches, sorrow into joy. Therefore, with all the angels of heaven, we lift our voices to proclaim the glory of your name and say our joyful hymn of praise. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Glory and honor and praise to you, holy and living God, to deliver us from the power of sin and death, and to reveal the riches of your grace. You looked with favor upon Mary, your willing servant, that she might conceive and bear a son, Jesus, the Holy Child of God. Living among us, Jesus loved us. He broke bread with outcasts and sinners, healed the sick, and proclaimed good news to the poor. He yearned to draw all the world to himself, yet we were heedless of his call to walk in love. Then the time came for him to complete upon the cross the sacrifice of his life, and to be glorified by you. On the night before Jesus died for us, Jesus was at table with his friends. He took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, and gave it to them, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." As supper was ending, Jesus took the cup of wine. Again, he gave thanks to you, gave it to them, and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for all for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Now, gathered at your table, O God of all creation, and remembering Christ crucified and risen, who was and is to come, we offer to you our gifts of bread and wine and ourselves a living sacrifice. Pour out your Spirit upon these gifts, that they may be the body and blood of Christ. Breathe your Spirit over the whole earth and make us your new creation, the body of Christ given for the world you have made. In the fullness of time, bring us with all your saints from every tribe and language and people and nation to feast at the banquet prepared from the foundation of the world. Through Christ and with Christ and in Christ, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, to you be honor, glory, and praise forever and ever. Amen.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior, Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen.
God of promise, you have prepared a banquet for us. Happy are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. There's a long-standing practice in the Episcopal Church to offer a means for people to receive Holy Communion spiritually when it cannot be received physically. I invite you to pray with me. My Jesus, I believe that you are truly present in the blessed sacrament of the altar. I love you above all things and long for you in my soul. Since I cannot receive you in the sacrament of your body and blood, come spiritually into my heart. Cleanse and strengthen me with your grace, Lord Jesus, and let me never be separated from you. May I live in you and you in me, in this life and in the life to come. Amen. God of glory, dwell in you richly. Name you beloved and shine brightly on your path. And the blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Amen.
And he will raise you up.
Go in peace, be the light of Christ. Thanks be to God.